very good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen, comrades and friends. Happy Africa Day to you all, especially to the revolutionaries in Africa and all Africans in general. I welcome you to this press conference, which we have called for under the banner of a movement which we are going to announce today. So before I proceed into giving that statement marking the launch of our movement, I would want to introduce you to those who are with me here up front. To my extreme left, we have Mike Mpofu. He is one of us in the organization and also in this revolution. And to my immediate left, we have a strong lady. She is Piwe. She's also part of us. And to my immediate right, we have Tinaye Mbabari. She's also one of us in the organization and also in this revolution. And to my extreme right, we have Rongai Zimudzi. She's also one of us in this revolution. So, like I said, revolutionary greetings to you all. I humbly welcome you all on my own behalf and on behalf of the movement, the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe, which is FEZ, or FEZ in short. That's the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe. So we welcome you all to this historic press conference, an event to announce the birth of the movement that seeks to undertake a mass-anchored and citizen-driven economic revolution in Zimbabwe. Comrades, it is not by mere coincidence or accident that this happens today, the 25th of May 2020, which is a day meant to celebrate Africa, our motherland. In choosing this day, the Africa Day, we did so deliberately in order to share with Africans, and Zimbabweans in particular, on our vision, on what we believe has to happen and what must be done going forward. So, here today we gather to make an announcement to Zimbabwe, Africa and the rest of the world, that here a generation has and is organizing itself to take up the unfinished business of the liberation struggle. The genuine economic emancipation of the indigenous people here in Zimbabwe. As I come to you today and make this statement, I'm neither a messiah nor a prophet. My only aspiration was and is to speak on behalf of fellow citizens who have been systematically silenced, those disinherited people of my country, Zimbabwe, those citizens economically excluded, exploited, and marginalized. In doing so, I'm heavily worried, not of the imminent danger and harm that will come our way, but of the fact that we may not succeed in making fellow citizens understand our genuine motive, or because of their past experiences. We understand that the majority of people are skeptical. At one point they were duped and had given up to fate and accepted their situation as the norm and order of the day. They had conformed, and I'm worried about how they will take our message. Knowing that the current situation that we face today is not a natural phenomenon, but a product of unjust economic practices by organized blood-sucking economic vampires, cannibalistic cartels, corrupt, selfish and heartless capitalists and monopolists, I have, together with some here, decided to take a stand, giving up the comfort and luxuries of our past association, to fight with many others for the sake of generations of current and the future. We have so much confidence in the revolutionary capabilities of ordinary human beings to accomplish this, because we believe in the men and women, young and old, so arrogantly dismissed, neglected, and pushed to the peripheries of their own economy, as second-class citizens in their own country of birth, and that Zimbabwe shall be built on a different economic and social foundation that will be created not by technocrats, financial wizards, or seasoned politicians, but by the indigenous masses of the toiling workers, miners, students, vendors, touts, farmers, craftsmen, artists, sportspersons, and all the youth and women whose labor and sweat, joined by the riches of nature, is the source of all wealth. We have gathered the courage to come out and speak to you and embark on this journey, which journey we know that it will be a journey of more than 1,000 miles, but which has to start from somewhere, and we have taken that very single step to mark the beginning of that journey. What is the background to today's event? I have no intention to lecture you on history, as I assume that we all know who we are, where we are coming from, where we are, and where we ought to be as a people. Africa, and Zimbabwe in particular, has come a long way. We have a history, and that history has become our teacher and point of reference as to what has to happen, and what we ought to do in order to achieve the dreams and aspirations of Africans and Zimbabweans in particular. We have a history characterized by heroic sacrifices, commitments, and struggles of the indigenous people against foreign domination, oppression, subjugation, discrimination, exploitation, corruption, exclusion, manipulation, marginalization, underdevelopment, and racial supremacy in our quest to establish a just and independent society that prides itself in being champions and advocates for self-determination. Our forebears in the majority of African countries at one point or the other organized themselves and took up arms against the colonialists and gained political independence from the former colonizers. We are grateful to those generations, those freedom fighters who paid for our political independence through their blood, sweat, and tears. We salute them. May the souls of the departed African heroes, and Zimbabweans in particular, rest in peace, and may the living ones who we have chosen to remain revolutionary be blessed and cherished. In the case of Zimbabwe, we got political independence, as you all know, from Britain in 1980, after years of a bitter and protracted struggle. At the center of this struggle for liberation were what our parents termed the national grievances, these being the concerns that they had against the settler regime, and what ultimately drove them to leave their homes, their worried parents, families, employment, schools, and everything they had wanted to enjoy, and committed to the struggle against the political and economic injustices. Besides the fight for political rights and independence, the freedom fighters wanted to have Zimbabweans in charge of their God-given resources, to have the opportunity to have the Zimbabwean majority enjoying equal access to economic opportunities, to own and control the means of production, and specifically land, and to have an enjoyable and prosperous life as an indigenous people, which life was being made miserable by a minority group of imperialists and capitalists. The freedom fighters wanted Zimbabweans to be in charge of their destiny politically and economically. 40 years down the line, to a very large extent, though it's debatable, we have witnessed the remarkable progress in terms of consolidating the gains of that struggle politically, though a lot is still to be done in regards to entrenching our democracy and the fundamental freedoms of the people. As you are aware, today we have plus or minus 100 political parties in Zimbabwe contesting for political office and mandate to govern at different levels. And this movement, the freedom, the front for economic emancipation in Zimbabwe, fees, wishes well to all the political players engaging in the struggle to achieve political freedoms and democracy for us. However, it is our considered view and opinion that not much has been achieved so far in terms of economic freedom and emancipation of our people, the indigenous majority, and not much attention and commitment has been given to address economic injustices prevailing in Zimbabwe. It is very sad and unfortunate that we have become so much obsessed with the power and struggles for the acquisition or protection of the same. We have become politically conscious but economically ignorant. To a very large extent, we have become a sloganeering, politicking and voting populace, paying less attention to the economic cause issues at hand, the bread and butter issues affecting us, and we have become economically stagnant and only get aroused and motivated to engage in mostly senseless and counterproductive political disputes and contestations for power driven by bitterness, hatred, desire for revenge, and score settling in our various political parties and also at national level, where anyone who gets power, whether real or imagined, goes all out to suffocate their perceived targets and outfox each other politically. For lack of a good term, I would submit that we have accumulated negative energy that has become self-destructive as a people. What is the current situation that is driving us as young people to come out and launch this economic revolution, to launch what we would term the Green Revolution under the banner of the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe? In order to ensure the successful execution of economic revolution here in Zimbabwe, we have to understand that there are some issues we have to look at and find ways to resolve them. And below are some of them, though the list is not exhaustive. One, we have to take note that from around 2000, a fast-track land reform program was a bad one. In our view, it was a very good first step. That land was taken from an estimated 4,000 white minority and redistributed to an estimated 300,000 to 400,000 black farmers or black Zimbabweans. However, it is our view that that land is not in the hands of the indigenous majority. It has been taken from a white minority into the hands of a black minority. So, who are the majority of the people who benefited under the land reform? They are largely a clique that belongs and or associated with one political party. And it happens that I'm one of the beneficiaries. I got land, and I know very well because it was made possible because I belonged to a certain political party. It's not to say all of the people who got that land are ZANU-PF, but to a very large extent, the beneficiaries of the land reform program belong to one political party. And to a very large extent, those not connected or associated to those in one political party have been sidelined and segregated against, and they have no access to that land, which also belongs to them as a national resource. Except for a few cases, land was and still continues to be distributed along partisan lines as politicians continue to be in charge of the land distribution process. As we speak, those who can't pay bribes to officials in charge of land allocation have been denied the right to land. Those who have also fallen out of favor with the leadership of the country are also having their farms taken away from them and being repossessed. You are all aware of the many cases that have flooded the courts, especially the High Court, where members of a certain faction in a certain political party are being persecuted because they've fallen out of favor with the leadership. And this is very sad. The authorities have embarked on a program to withdraw that claim from those they do not agree with politically. And it is very unfortunate that land has been weaponized and politicized to an extent that whosoever disagrees with the authorities is threatened with land withdrawal or actual withdrawal. And on a very sad note, still on the issue of land, the authorities seem committed to reverse the land reform and give back that land to former commercial farmers on various dubious grounds. This is despite the fact that hundreds of thousands, if not millions of indigenous Zimbabweans have been and are still waiting patiently to get that small piece of land and produce. And the government of today, our current government, has come up with a statutory instrument under the guise of wanting to compensate the former commercial farmers, when in fact they intend to reverse that land reform. You could also appreciate that men across the country have been evicted and ejected from farms they occupied many years ago, as only the politically powerful and connected are now getting that land. We have the case of those who have benefited land in Kiret. Thousands of families face an ejection from the land they had occupied for so many years because the authorities say they have found an investor. And they want to get rid of those people who had benefited from that land. Offer letters have not been dispersed as anticipated after many years of unfulfilled promises by power-seeking politicians during election time. Those connected and powerful in our society have been given 99-year leases, while some have offer letters, and the rest have nothing to show except the word of promise by a politician seeking votes. The majority have no security of tenure on the land that they have occupied. And this will continue, if not challenged, because the authorities would want people to continue to have this sense of insecurity, to say, if I go against the government, or if I disagree with the party in government, I will have my land withdrawn. And this is the reason why people are not being given 99-year leases since 2000. The leases have only been given to those in power and position of influence. And it's very sad. While the majority of Zimbabweans seek a very small piece of land and they have no access to it, a minority clique has vast tracts of land and multiple farms stretching into thousands of hectares, even when they know that the current farm ownership policy says the maximum farm size that one has got must have is 400 hectares. But those in power, they have more than 400 hectares. They have farms with thousands of hectares, and then they have multiple farms. And there are also some farms that are being kept for unborn babies and the children of powerful politicians who are out of this country, who do not even have an interest in farming, while we have Zimbabweans wanting to have that land. While men await the results of a supposed land audit, the bitter truth and the reality of the day is that high-ranking officials within the government and one party have already parceled out the land amongst themselves, And this is the truth. Go wherever and confirm what I'm saying. When they will come up with the land audit report, there will be no land for you. And it happens that at one point when I was still a member of a certain political party, I went to Kipinge and addressed young people there who were demanding land, saying we were promised land from 2010 when we had a conference in Mtare, that all the remaining land would be given to the youth and women. And where is that land? And that was in 2019. And I said to them, let's wait for the finalization of the land audit. Or if you are not patient, find something that you can do to get the attention of the leadership so that you are given that land. And I'll say today that they organized themselves into around 700 youths in Kipingu, and they occupied a farm. And for me then to know that they had occupied a farm in Kipingu, I was called to the office of one high-ranking official who is a member of the presidium to warn me that we have to stop to encourage young people to ask for land. And I said, no, but chef, year in, year out, the party is saying, my youth, don't get it from me. There is no such thing. That's a damn thing. And ask those young people there if any of them has got land, including the deputy nation, if the acting deputy national secretary for youth affairs, he doesn't have land. They have raised it a number of times to the party leadership in the briefings with the presidium and everyone, and they have not shown any willingness to give land to young people. While they have vast tracts of land, thousands of hectares, and multiple farms. So young people out there, and all Zimbabweans who are in need of land, must understand that it is not going to come to them on a silver platter. It was easy to take it from a white minority, but I don't think it would be easy for you and me to get it from a black minority, especially the ones who are in office. They are not ready to do that. And it would be foolish on our part to think that at one point, those in a political role of a certain party and those in the cabinet will sit down on their own and say, we have multiple farms, can we please share it with those who don't have land? They are not going to do that. So, what do we have to do? Should the land remain in the hands of a minority? Definitely not. Which is why we are coming out to launch this green revolution, the economic revolution, to make sure that everyone has equal access to national resources. These resources do not belong to a certain political party. They belong to all Zimbabweans. And it has to be corrected. But get it from me, it's not going to be a straw in the park. They will resist. But we have to do everything necessary to make sure that that land is shared equally and to people who have the capacity and the potential to produce. Some of those who have land today have become soya beans farmers. Not soya beans, I mean soya. Some are cellphone farmers. Some are visiting farmers to their own plot of land that they were allocated. And these are issues that have to be dealt with. And this is the reason why we are also coming up with this platform and this green revolution under the banner of the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe. Production of the farms is implemented as many are nothing but cell phone and visiting farmers. We have no commitment to farm and produce for the country, and as such we continue to experience food insecurity and largely rely on grain imports. No meaningful and sustainable farmer support schemes have been put in place to enable and empower the farmer to produce, while some have abused their available, though disorganized, facilities, and by doing so they have deprived the country of food security and revival of the agricultural industry. Related to this, farmers have also been made unable to enjoy products of their sweat and the returns of their investments through unfair marketing models and exploitative practices, which have been condoned by the authorities. Not much has been done to defend the farmers against exploitation and manipulation. An example being what tobacco farmers are experiencing currently at the tobacco auction floors. While a certain percentage of their tobacco is being bought using forex, the other percentage is being bought using RTGS at the rate of 1:25, when the officials know very well that after the farmers have sold their tobacco, they will not be able again to go back into the fields. They are very much aware even of the parallel forex rates, and they are giving the farmers half of what is being given, of what is available in terms of forex rates on the parallel market. And how is the farmer going to manage to go back into the field? So this is also one of the reasons why we are here as young people, to say we have to deal with this issue. We cannot continue to have our farmers being manipulated, being exploited by a few greedy and individuals connected to the powerful. We cannot allow that. The second issue why we are coming up with this revolution is because the hopes of Zimbabweans have been dealt a huge blow by a demon that has ravaged our economic society, which demon has been birthed, nurtured and sponsored by the powerful in our society. And this demon is corruption. You know very well that at one point, with my colleague, we came out to name certain individuals. We alleged to be corrupt. And what happened to us? Everyone knows. Summarily, we got suspended without even a chance of a hearing. We got expelled. Why? Because tangata nobata panyama nete. Those we had named are not even belong to any political party. Or were they politicians? But all of you saw politicians spending all their time in their political defending those whom we had accused. And that is a clear indication of where corruption is being nurtured. They had to rush to defend those people because we were awaiting their next action. We were told that they had said they were going to sue us, but they didn't. To this day, we are yet to receive support
because we were waiting for them. And what they did was,
ukarola munhu
takabata zita rainai. Vatakanga tabata taifunga
kuti havana chekuita neparty, but takazoona leadership yeparty yaakupindira.
So, this is the situation that we have.
And it is certain to note that despite sweet sounding promises and pledges by those in leadership to deal with the scourge, they have done the opposite by protecting and befriending the corrupt. It has turned out to be all rhetoric and no action in addressing this problem. It is said that in Zimbabwe, we continue to witness the arrest and the persecution of petty pickpockets, while grand looters, criminals and thieves roam the streets and boast of their ill-gotten wealth. Thieves and looters have been promoted into public office, either in central government or local government. Corruption has become a way of living, and there is no motivation for honesty and hard work. Corruption is evident across the divide, be it in the ruling party controlled central government, or in the opposition-led town councils and municipalities. And when it happens, though very rare, that thieves associated with one major party are arrested, the criminals are surprisingly defended and represented by lawyers who happen to be leaders of the second major political party in Zimbabwe.
When they get to their rally,
they say those from that party are thieves.
But before the day ends,
they are in the courts defending the same thieves. They say they are against. And it is very unfortunate that we as Zimbabweans have allowed these politicians to hoodwink us through this game. The authorities have been so effective in arresting and jailing touts, vendors, makorokoza and street prostitutes, while paying no attention to grand looters and thieves in our society, who are the associates in crime. Institutions mandated to deal with crimes of corruption and deliver justice, for reasons best known to themselves, seem not willing to deal with corruption decisively and are reluctant to act. Unfortunately, citizens are patiently waiting and expecting thieves to order their own arrests. It's very sad.
And it's not going to happen. And this is the reason why
we have decided to constitute ourselves into this citizens' movement, to say we have to cause
for the authorities to not only address corruption issues
or attend to corruption issues, but also for them to stop being corrupt, because they are equally corrupt.
And the majority of those we have been pointing at are mere friends. Those who have been getting tenders from government are doing so because those in government are their associates. Those who have been getting even concessions, mineral concessions everywhere, are doing so because they are a friend to those in government, the power.
So, for how long are we going to wait for them to arrest themselves?
What do we have to do?
It's unfortunate that we continue to wait.
But with the coming in of
this movement,
this is going to be a thing of the past.
We know it's not going to be a story of the past. But I think we have come to a stage where we are ready to take them head on.
I think it's time they come out in the open, whether to be with the people and do which is right or wrong, to face the citizens. And this we are going to do. This is not a threat. I'm not in the habit of issuing empty threats. I'm not one of those. And we mean business. The third reason why we are coming up with this economic revolution, which we have termed the Green Revolution, under the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe, is because of issues to do with economic empowerment. And what has been said and promised about the economic emancipation of Zimbabwe, especially the youth and women, but what we continue to experience today is exactly the opposite of that which we have been promised, and never what we have expected. Supposed empowerment programs have just been nothing but smoke screens and window dressing antics by the authorities. Our movement decries lack of genuine will by the authorities to empower the people. It has just become a traditional campaign message for the politicians. Deliberately, politicians are not going to empower anyone, because if one gets empowered, they may develop a thick head and refuse to be manipulated and abused. And for that reason, for all the politicians from across the political divide are not ready to empower their followers, because you must remain a beggar. If you call them and say, "I need airtime," they'll give you not the means to get your own airtime. They'll give you airtime maybe worth $5. They have been calculated that maybe it would only be enough for a day or two. And if a week passes without you going back to them to seek the same airtime, they will become worried. Because they know that you don't have the capacity on your own to buy that airtime. And they will start to investigate to see who is now sponsoring you with that airtime if it is not coming from them. During each and every election, manifestos are printed, making fresh pronouncements on the massive empowerment initiatives that would be undertaken, and nothing substantial is materialized. Though the Constitution demands that the state must embark on the affirmative action programs, nothing is coming the way of the ordinary indigenous person. The empowerment drive has died. Of late, it has become increasingly difficult for any enterprising person to operate and flourish under the prevailing conditions. Instead, the authorities have been working hard to create a conducive environment for foreign capital under the Zimbabwe's open for business mantra, while not doing enough for the indigenous investor and entrepreneur. Do Zimbabweans not deserve the same treatment at the hands of their own government? Imagine the tax-free holidays given to some foreign investors under unclear and dubious grounds, when no incentive has been put in place for the local enterprising companies and individuals. Not that everyone expects financial help from the government, no, but many just want unhindered access to opportunities. Not what we experience today, that when you are not connected or related to someone in government or in a certain political party, then you have no chance at getting the opportunities. In the majority of cases, when any local business person or company would have been awarded any business opportunity, it would be because of nepotism, regionalism, and tribalism, which is now a trademark of the current leadership in the ruling party and in government. We continue to see a few individuals being awarded business opportunities, while the rest get elbowed out. These individuals would grab every opportunity that arises using different company names, and this is so because the influence of high-ranking officials in government they work with who are their associates in crime. The fourth reason why we are launching the Green Revolution, it is because we have noted, sadly, that the authorities seem to have committed to hand over the ownership of our God-given natural resources to foreigners who are on a looting spree with the aid of the government and leadership. You are aware of how, for example, the Chinese have dominated every economic sector and every space. Besides coming from China to mold bricks here, they have been given control over all our natural resources. And this is being done with the help of those in government. It is said to note that none Africans have become a priority of this government as they loot our diamonds, gold, platinum, chrome, lithium, and many other minerals. For example, those looters have been given unhindered access to our rivers to supposedly embark on what they term desiltation, while it's polluting our environment, putting cyanide, putting mercury into our rivers, while any indigenous person found within those same rivers trying to eke out a living has been condemned to not less than 24 months in prison for illegal mining. The marauding so-called investors have been diverting and disturbing our rivers with the express authority of the government. Recently, villagers in Uzumba, which is a stronghold of a certain political party, have had their crops and sources of livelihood destroyed by the so-called investors who enjoy protection from politicians and the authorities, as they seem to have been licensed to do as they please in our community. As we speak, Zimbabwe and all the communities that boast of vast mineral deposits have nothing to show for all the minerals that they have that have been taken out of their communities. What does Zimbabwe, let alone the Manicaland province, has to show for the diamonds they had or they still have? You are all aware that when Manicaland was struck with cyclone, he died. They could not help themselves, and they had to wait for donations of second-hand and torn clothes from outside the Manicaland province. How do we justify that? Where are those diamonds going to? Who owns those diamonds and who controls them? What does Mutombo have to show for all the granite that has been taken away? Nothing. Imagine one person who has been christened Peter by the authorities has been awarded 4 gas concessions in Lupane, as if people from Lupane deserve nothing. Why is that so? What is there for us as a country from those taking out our resources day and night? Why are we this poor when minerals are being taken out of Zimbabwe every second? It so happens that we have very rich mines in a very poor community. We have a problem with the ownership model of mineral resources in Zimbabwe, where you have one rich individual, because that person has managed to register that claim, either of gold or whatever mineral that it is, operating that mine in a very poor community, which cannot afford to build even one blade toilet. In a poor community, which cannot afford to build schools for its children, to have an ambulance for its hospitals. When one person can afford to build a 30-roomed, 60-built, 50-built, 50-roomed mansion, he's got a fleet of cars, but taking resources from a community that cannot afford anything. And as a community, and as an organization, and as a movement, these are issues we also seek to deal with under what we term the economy, the green revolution. The other thing that we're also going to do as a movement is to ensure transparency and accountability. People are aware that we have been receiving Zupco buses or buses operating under the franchise of Zupco. But who is the owner of those buses? Which buses have not been branded? Only a sticker has been attached to those buses. We have heard a lot about those buses. This is just one of the many examples of cases that demand transparency and accountability from the government and from the authorities. So it also happens that both many major political parties would want to have credit for what they think are good things that would have happened in the community. You are aware that the two major political parties had a fight on social media, each of them claiming credit for a mere roundabout. But recently, when market stores were being destroyed, both of them denied responsibility and ownership of the problem. These ones would say it's coming, it's an order coming from the government, and these ones would say it's coming from an opposition-led town council. So this movement is also going to demand transparency and accountability from the authorities. And we are also going to deal with issues of leadership capture. Because leadership has been captured. Leadership from both political parties has been captured. They are getting sponsorship from cartels and their associates in crime. And we challenge them to come out in the open and deny this. And members of a certain political party are even receiving vehicles, they are receiving salaries, fuel and donations from the very same people who are corrupt and who drive cartels in Zimbabwe that have been manipulating Zimbabweans. And the other thing that we're also going to deal with under the Green Revolution are issues to deal with unemployment and poverty. Graduates are being turned out year in, year out, and they are not going anywhere. And this movement is not just going to be seen mourning and complaining. We are an action-oriented movement. We are going to come up with alternative programs and initiatives to assist our own, our fellow citizens in Zimbabwe. We are also going to deal, to demand the authorities to deal with issues of currency, issues of the black market, issues of misplaced priorities, issues of the workforce that has been neglected and abandoned by those in government and also by the trade unions that are supposed to be representing them, which trade unions have also chosen to be political commissars of certain political parties. And if we are to have a successful economic revolution in Zimbabwe, we must then have a motivated workforce. And this movement believes that it is high time that those in the labor sector reorganize themselves so that they continue to represent their own interests. In conclusion, what are we saying? What we are saying as a movement is, we are going to take charge of our own destiny. For too long we have relied on politicians, those from the other party have been around for 40 years, go to where they have strongholds. You will see nothing happening in those strongholds. Those who have been in the opposition, in charge of local municipalities in towns, have been around for 20 years. Come into the areas where they are in charge. There is equally nothing. So, what we are going to do is we are going to conscientize the citizens so that they realize that they are on their own. No politician or no political party is there for them. And it's high time we unite as citizens. You can't belong to your party, be it Zanupe, be it MDC, be it Mabambo, be it whatever, or to any faction of any political party. We don't care about that. The front for economic emancipation in Zimbabwe is coming in as a voluntary, apolitical, non-partisan, and inclusive, radical and militant economic emancipation movement of the United Citizens of Zimbabwe, who include, but are not limited to, the youth and women, patriots and activists, workers, students, liberation veterans, civil society organizations, miners, farmers, industry leaders, entrepreneurs, community-based organizations, and lobby groups, pursuing the struggle to achieve a genuinely prosperous and corrupt-free Zimbabwe. So we are coming in as advocates for self-determination and committed to undertake an economic revolution in Zimbabwe. So, this is who we are, and this is the reason why we are here. Taking the leadership to account, dealing with employment issues affecting our people, making sure that there is equal access to national resources and opportunities to all Zimbabwean citizens, including them. And we are going to do it to make sure that land is redistributed equally among all the citizens of Zimbabwe, regardless of one's political affiliation or religious affiliation or whatever it might turn out to be. So, this is why we called for this press conference, to alert Zimbabwe to say, here we are. Come, let's join hands. Be part of this movement. Be part of the movement to economically liberate yourself, to take leadership to account, to promote transparency, to ensure equal access to resources and opportunities. So, comrades and friends, we are sorry for taking much of your time, but basically, this is who we are. We are not a movement that will exist on social media platforms. We will be getting to the ground. we'll be getting to the grassroots. You will see us in Wange, down there in Mushika and Nyabawa. You will see us in Cholocho, you will see us in Kipini. You will also see us in Zaraka. You will see us in Ekwe. Glendora will be there as a pro-poor movement. So, we thank you so much. Unless there are any questions from you members of the media fraternity, then we can call it a day.
How does one join the movement?
Okay, thank you so much. We have two forms of membership to the organization. We have what we may term active membership, which requires one to join the movement formally and be part of its programs and structures. We also have what we call associate membership, which is meant for organizations that may want to be part of this movement, the Front for Economic Emancipation in Zimbabwe. Then we have another concept for those who want to volunteer in the membership and not really be part of the structure, but who want to be part of the movement through various programs. So when one wants to join the movement, they are free to contact us. We are going to be having coordinators at all levels. At national level, at the provincial level, at all levels, cascading down to the grassroots. We are not going to be a movement in the air. We are going to the paddocks, dealing with the issues affecting the people. So everyone is welcome, young and old, to this movement. Maybe to clarify a bit, we have two professional units under this movement. The first one is the Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Citizens Task Force, which will be manned by a few people to deal professionally and strategically with issues of corruption and liaise with existing institutions constitutionally mandated to deal with corruption, like the ZRP, like Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Commission, like the National Prosecuting Authority, and other organizations. So that is a smaller unit under the broader movement. Then we also have a smaller unit to deal with issues of empowerment. That unit is called the National Affirmative Action Assembly of Zimbabwe. And these two wings belong to the broader movement, but pursuing different or specific assignments on behalf of the broader movement. When corruption issue cases arise, we refer them to the Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Citizens Task Force, which then takes them to a relevant organ, so that we don't become a movement of press conferences, a movement on social media, but a movement that seeks to deal directly with the issues on the ground. Thank you so much for that question. Any other question? No, thank you so much.